Hi, a very good morning. So I have the following message for you. Bahut bahut shubh prabhat. Aasha hai ki aap aur aapka parivar surakshit hai. Khyal rakhna. Okay. So today's live session will focus on the following case-based patient. We'll discuss the context and also we'll discuss related patients. And today's live session, I'm going to give you some homework as well. So I prepared some interesting questions for you. You can find out and get back through mail for further discussion. Okay? So before we proceed, I hope I'm audible, and also I'm going to raise my voice in this live session because I've been getting feedback asking me to increase the volume. Okay? Right. So I hope it is all streaming fine and all good. So let's start with the given context and then proceed with questions. As you can see, a 42-year-old male patient, remember it's a male patient, comes to your clinic with a chief complaint of redness in posterior area of tongue, asymptomatic, with no significant medical history. Clinical examination reveals smooth, flat, erythematous area on posterior dorsum of the tongue. So this is the context. So I'll show you a clinical image and let me know what your diagnosis is based on the same. So this is the clinical image. Okay. So as discussed, a male patient, a middle-aged 42-year-old, comes to your clinic with a chief complaint of redness in posterior area of tongue, asymptomatic. Clinical examination reveals smooth, flat, erythematous area on posterior dorsum of tongue. You can see dimensions roughly around 2 to 3 centimeters maximum, right? And also you can, it's evident that this lesion seems to be present anterior to circumvallate papilla. Overall in the posterior aspect of dorsum of the tongue. So in your opinion, what could be the most probable diagnosis? And you have the following options:
hairy tongue, median rhomboid glossitis, posterior midline atrophic candidiasis, options B and C. So which one do you think is the most appropriate answer? Okay, let me give you a hint. Option D is not the right answer. Option D is not the right answer. So exclude option D. Now tell me which among A, B, C is more appropriate answer. So as you can see, as most of you mentioned, it seems to be a median rhomboid glossitis, rhomboid shape, smooth texture. Sometimes it can be lobulated as well. And it appears erythematous. And it's obvious that the papilla are absent, even taste buds are absent. It's present in posterior midline of tongue on the dorsum, not on the ventral side. And also it's present anterior to circumvallate papilla. So obviously, it comes to this diagnosis, that is median rhomboid glossitis. But as most of you are aware of, there has been a recent shift in the way in which this particular lesion is being visualized, viewed and studied. It's considered to be a form of candidiasis, chronic atrophic candidiasis. So the more appropriate diagnostic term that has to be used as per Schaeffer's and as per several articles available in PubMed, posterior midline atrophic candidiasis. Previously it was called as median rhomboid glossitis, but now the most appropriate term would be posterior midline atrophic candidiasis. Because previously, as you know, it was thought to be a developmental defect. And coming to developmental aspect, you know, lingual swellings, tuberculum impar, hyperbronchial eminence, derived from first, second, third, and fourth branchial arches. And also, you know, the corresponding nerve supply. So this defect was thought to be because of incomplete fusion in the posterior dorsal point, leaving a rhomboid-shaped defect. But recent studies show that it's a more or less a form or type of candidiasis. So, among the given options, option C would be the most appropriate one. I hope it's clear. A very good morning. Now, if you have any questions, you are free to ask and get back through mail 24/7. Okay? I hope you're convinced. Now, moving on to the next question. Patient also demonstrates midline soft palate erythema, which is kissing disease. True or false? What would you say? And here is the clinical image. So patient also demonstrates midline soft palate erythema, which is kissing disease. True or false? Okay, it seems some of you, almost many of you have chosen true, but carefully go through the answer which is given here. It's not kissing disease. If it is kissing disease, then it has to be false. Kissing disease, glandular fever, infectious mononucleosis caused by Epstein-Barr virus, that's a different story. This is a kissing lesion. As you can see, because of proximity and contact with the particular aspect, on the posterior aspect of tongue, there is even palatal erythema, especially on soft palate, which is called as kissing lesion. It's not kissing disease. Both are different, okay? Wonderful. Now, let's move on to the next question. On further examination, you notice dental caries in relation to 1/6 and you decided to take an intraoral periapical radiograph. We discussed about biting and periapical radiograph yesterday, if you remember, which reveals coronal radiolucency extending from enamel into dentin in relation to 1/6. Incidentally, you also notice radiolucency involving enamel in relation to 1/7. However, clinically the tooth is sound. This appearance could be due to all except. Options include wear, cervical burnout, pits, MAC band effect. So which one do you think is more appropriate answer? So clinically, the tooth appears to be sound. We're talking about 1/7. But radiographically, there seems to be some radiolucency in the enamel or in the coronal area. So this appearance could be due to all except. Okay, well tried. I see most of you choosing, almost all options, A, B, D. And why did you leave out option C? You think you can undermine and underestimate pits? Okay, well tried. The answer is none. This appearance could be due to, so this false positive, which means, first of all, I want to make this clear. Clinically, if you don't find caries lesion on the occlusal surface and you find it radiographically or through other diagnostic tests, then it's obviously occult caries, right? I hope there's no confusion. Occult caries, that's a separate entity. We're not discussing about that. In this context, you are sure that clinically there is no caries. You have done a dye 40, transillumination, and electrical conductance test, and you have confirmed that there is no caries clinically and also through these tests. But radiographically, in relation to 1/7, there is radiolucency which indicates false positive response, right? False positive. So this false positive is because of all of the following except. So false positive can be because of wear, cervical burnout, MAC band effect, pits, and fissures as well. So all of these contribute to false positive response, right? So which one is exception? None of the above. I hope you got my point. We're not talking about occult caries. We have confirmed that there is no caries clinically and with all other relevant tests. But radiographically, you find this radiolucency. That means there is false positive interpretation. We're saying there is no actual caries, but you're saying there is caries based on radiographic appearance, which could be due to either wear, cervical burnouts, MAC band effect, pit and fissures, hypoplastic defects, isn't it? Even fractures, I hope you got my point, right? Okay, I hope it's clear. And now let's move on to the next question. You decide to restore 1/6. So you noticed here is you decided to restore 1/6. Which of the following is or are primary cusp or cusps in relation to 1/6? It's a permanent tooth. Mesobuccal, mesopalatal, distobuccal, distopalatal cusp of caribellus. Among them, which of them is primary cusp or primary cusps? Yes, Rahil, cervical burnout seen in cervical aspect. Yeah. Which of the following is or are a primary cusp or primary cusps? Okay, A, B, good. What about C, D, and D? Urvi seems to be smart. She has chosen A, B, C, D. Yes, VT, Arushi. Okay, well tried. You should understand that there are primary and secondary cusps. Developmentally, three cusps are considered to be primary. Mesopalatal and two buccal cusps. So as we have seen, one of the occlusal illustration of the first molar. So you can see this is mesopalatal cusp, right? Mesopalatal cusp and two buccal cusps. Mesobuccal, distobuccal cusps. So these are considered as primary cusps. Okay, just observe this illustration carefully. Okay, observe this very carefully because I'm going to ask you another related question. Okay, just keep this illustration in your mind and visualize the same. You can see the largest cusp mesopalatal, right? Distopalatal, distobuccal, mesobuccal, isn't it? And also you have cusp of Caribelli. So just observe, and as we have discussed, these three are your primary cusps, that is mesopalatal and two buccal cusps. Okay. So I hope you got the answer. So A, B, and C are primary cusps. What about distopalatal and cusp of Caribelli? These are secondary cusps. Okay, now let's move on to, additional cusp of Caribelli. Okay, now let's move on to the final question. To address patient's chief complaint, right, which we discussed prior, and also you'll see in a clinical image, which of the following is prescribed? Tetracycline, cefaclor, clotrimazole, none of the above. You'll have a related question. Let's see how many of you are going to answer it. So it addresses the patient's chief complaint. The diagnosis you established is posterior midline atrophic candidiasis. So which of the following would you prescribe? Tetracycline, cefaclor, clotrimazole, none of the above. Arjun is asking some question. Arjun, you can just refer Wheelers and get back through mail via doubt clarification form. We'll discuss it over there. Yeah, so obviously clotrimazole, which is the first choice drug as we discussed in one of the previous live sessions, nystatin being the second choice drug. So clotrimazole, 10 milligram trochet, right? I'll show you the image. It's nothing but small medicated lozenges which are available. So these dissolve very slowly. So as you can see, these are lozenges. Trochet. Okay, so 10 milligrams of the same, 3 to 4 times daily, right? For addressing this candidiasis, okay? Now, we have completed the discussion. Let me ask you related questions. I'll see to that you're making note of the same. Consider that as your homework, and then you can get back through mail for discussion. Those who are interested, you're most welcome. So first homework question. See, you know that patient has the following condition to rule out malignancy, because erythematous lesion, asymptomatic, dorsum side, posterior aspect of tongue, to rule out malignancy, you have planned a biopsy. Let's suppose you have planned a biopsy. In such a case, when do you institute antifungal therapy? Is it before biopsy or after biopsy? That's the question. So the first question is, to rule out malignancy, you are planning a biopsy. So if you are planning a biopsy, when do you institute antifungal therapy? Before biopsy or after biopsy? You need not answer now. So that's the first question for you. And the second question is, we have discussed about false positive responses. So there is no caries, but there seems to be some caries lesion radiographically, false positive. And the opposite is false negative, isn't it? There is caries, but you don't detect it clinically. Even that's possible. So among false positive and false negative responses or interpretations, which one do you think is a severe mistake? I'm quoting severe mistake. It's going to be very interesting to find out. So among false positive and false negative, which one is a severe mistake? Comparatively, okay? Now the third question is, the third question is related to this. So the third question is, which cusps, I asked you to remember the illustration. So which cusps of maxillary first molar form primary cusp triangle? Which of them form primary cusp triangle? So these are your three homework questions. So those who are interested, you can refer, get back through mail for discussion. I'll be more than happy to discuss with you. Okay? So I hope it's clear, and before we conclude, let's summarize all that we have discussed so far. So you've seen, in fact, I wanted to highlight this. I mentioned male patient because posterior midline atrophic candidiasis, median rhomboid glossitis, it has male predilection, male to female of 3:1. Okay, I wanted to signify that point as well. So a male patient comes to your clinic with chief complaint of redness, erythema, right? And you've seen the clinical image. And clinical examination reveals smooth, flat, erythematous area on the posterior dorsum of the tongue, rhomboid shape. So based on clinical findings, your diagnosis is posterior midline atrophic candidiasis, which is more appropriate, the diagnostic term, okay, currently. And patient also demonstrates midline soft palate erythema, which is kissing lesion, not kissing disease. And also on examination, you went for IOPA. And there is a false positive response, which could be because of the following factors. So except, so it would be none. And then we have discussed about the primary cusps. Which of them are primary cusps in case of first molar? Well done. And to address patient's chief complaint, which are the following drugs you prescribe? Antifungal, troche, lozenges, clotrimazole 10 mg 3-4 times a day, dissolve slowly in mouth. And also I gave you some homework questions. You're planning a biopsy, so when do you institute antifungal therapy? Before or after biopsy, and also why? It's going to be very interesting, okay? And also I've asked you to find out about which is more severe mistake, false positive or false negative. And also I've asked you to find out what constitutes or which cusps form maxillary molars, primary cusp triangle, okay? So these are some of the questions we wanted to highlight in this specific video. I hope the session is informative, and also I hope you enjoyed the questions. See to that you're maintaining notes, which is very, very important. No matter which sessions you're attending, see to that you're maintaining notes on a consistent basis, and all it takes is 5-10 minutes to just note down a few key points pertaining to this discussion, and then you can extend your notes by referring, and then, you know, adding elaborate extensions wherever necessary. And all it would take is 20 to 30 minutes or a maximum of 40 minutes, which is qualitative. And before I conclude, again, I would like to repeat my message. Bahut bahut shubh prabhat. It's done, we already wished. Aasha hai ki aap aur aapka parivar surakshit hai. Khayal rakhna. Okay? So tomorrow I'll try another language. And I'll see you again tomorrow at 10:30 a.m. Indian Standard Time. Stay home, stay safe. Wish you all the best, love you all, and have a nice day ahead. Take care.